I think everyone at least once in their life has wondered, how vast is the universe? What lies beyond it? Welcome to Enigma Files. Today, we'll delve into these questions and explore the size of the universe. Before discussing how big the universe is, let's consider another question first. What's our address in the universe? Everyone knows their home address, right? But what about your cosmic address? Listen carefully. The universe. Laniaka supercluster. Virgo cluster. Local group. Milky Way galaxy. Orion arm. Solar system, third planet. Earth. That's Earth's address in the universe. Add your home address at the end, and voila, your complete universal address. Now, let's analyze the size of the universe using this address as a guide. Starting with Earth, the third planet of the solar system, which we all know well. Next level up, the Orion arm of the Milky Way galaxy. The Milky Way is a spiral galaxy, and galaxies come in all sorts of shapes. Some look like wheels, others like spheres, or even Z-shaped structures. The Milky Way has four major spiral arms. Cygnus arm, Perseus arm, Sagittarius arm, Crux arm. But we're not located on any of these main arms. Instead, we're on a smaller one called the Orion arm. One reason life exists on Earth is because our location is relatively empty, unlike the densely packed regions of the major spiral arms, which make it harder for life to develop. We reside in a quiet, open space. The solar system has a radius of about 2 light-years. But how big is the Milky Way? Its diameter is 100,000 light-years. This means our solar system is just a tiny speck in the galaxy. It's located about halfway from the Milky Way's center to its edge, approximately 25,000 light-years from the edge. To put it into perspective, it would take the Voyager spacecraft 50,000 years to leave the solar system. To escape the Milky Way, it would take 500 million years. The Milky Way contains an estimated 200 to 400 billion stars. If each star had a system like the solar system, that's 200 to 400 billion planetary systems. However, because of the Milky Way's immense size, much of it is just empty space. The stars, while numerous, are like dust particles scattered in a vast void, barely perceptible. Similarly, the universe feels like a gigantic space filled with countless tiny particles, much like dust in the air around us, invisible to the naked eye. The closest galaxy to the Milky Way is the Andromeda Galaxy, which is twice the size of our galaxy. The largest known galaxy in the universe, IC 1101, is 10 times bigger than Andromeda. Andromeda is about 2.5 million light-years away and is approaching us at a speed of 120 kilometers per second. In 2 to 4 billion years, the Milky Way and Andromeda will collide and eventually merge into a single galaxy. But this collision won't happen all at once. The galaxies will crash, separate, and repeat this cycle until they gradually merge. The resulting galaxy has been tentatively named Milkomeda, combining the names of the Milky Way and Andromeda. Galaxies are collections of stars, but groups of galaxies form galaxy clusters. Our Milky Way, Andromeda, and the Triangulum Galaxy, along with some smaller galaxies, form the local group, which spans 10 million light years. The local group, along with over 100 other galaxy groups, makes up the Virgo supercluster, with a diameter of about 110 million light years. In 2014, researchers from the University of Lyon and the University of Hawaii discovered that the Virgo supercluster is actually part of an even larger structure called the Laniakea supercluster, which spans 520 million light-years. Laniakea contains three primary superclusters: Virgo supercluster, Hydrogen Taurus supercluster, Pavo Indus supercluster. These superclusters were originally separate but are now converging due to a massive gravitational anomaly called the Great Attractor. The Great Attractor is not a black hole. It's a colossal gravitational center unlike anything we've encountered. It's obscured by the Milky Way's dense star fields, so we can't directly observe it. But its pull is strong enough to draw in three entire superclusters. There are about 10 million superclusters like Laniakea in the observable universe, collectively forming what we recognize as the cosmos. From our vantage point, the universe appears spherical and we perceive ourselves as its center. The observable universe has a radius of 46.5 billion light years and a diameter of 93 billion light years. This defines the limit of what we can see, the observable universe. Even though galaxies and superclusters are scattered across this vast expanse, they are interconnected, like dust particles linked by invisible threads. These threads form a network-like structure that, surprisingly, mirrors the neural networks of the human brain. This resemblance has led to speculation. Could the universe itself be the brain of some colossal being? And if so, does that mean our own brains might contain tiny universes? The observable radius of the universe is 46.5 billion light years. How do we know this distance? Did we really see a place 46.5 billion light years away? Is that the edge of the universe? Actually, this distance is calculated, not directly observed. We haven't truly seen that far, but we have detected things from that far away. It's common knowledge that the universe is 13.8 billion years old. Theoretically, we should only be able to see up to 13.8 billion light years away. And in practice, this is true. Currently, the farthest galaxy we've observed is about 13.3 billion light years away. We've also identified the oldest known star, called Methuselah's star. Methuselah, a biblical figure, is said to have lived the longest. This star's age is roughly 13.7 billion years. Before addressing why we can see 46.5 billion light years away, let's first talk about how we observe the universe. Humans first started using telescopes to observe the cosmos 400 years ago, in 1609. Galileo, with a handmade telescope magnifying just 33 times, saw the moon and the satellites around Jupiter. He realized that Earth might not be the center of the universe. His telescope, which was the world's first astronomical telescope, had a diameter of only 4 centimeters. A 33x telescope like that seems primitive by today's standards, more like a toy telescope. Normally, you wouldn't expect to see Jupiter's moons with it, but Galileo did see them. What does this tell us? It shows that ancient people had exceptionally sharp eyesight. Think about it. 6,500 years ago, the Sumerians reportedly identified 9 planets in our solar system, using only their eyes. In China, 2,000 years ago, the astronomical record in Zizhi Tongjian mentions Jupiter's movements. All of this was done with the naked eye. The visual acuity of ancient people is almost unimaginable. Perhaps it's because our eyesight has deteriorated over time. For example, in Kenya, there's a tribe called the Maasai who lead a pastoral life. Their eyesight is extraordinary. They can see objects 10 kilometers away. This ability helps them spot lions from a distance, avoiding danger without getting too close. So it's possible that 2 or 3,000 years ago, people could see Jupiter and Saturn with their naked eyes. When we gaze at the night sky, all the stars seem to twinkle alike, but they're actually very different. Stars farther away take longer for their light to reach us. So what we see is the past of those stars, not their present. For instance, when we look at the moon, we see it as it was 1 second ago. When we look at the sun, we see it as it was 8 minutes ago. For stars farther away, we might be seeing them as they were decades or even centuries ago. The entire night sky is a snapshot of cosmic history. This raises an intriguing question. If the night sky represents the universe's history, shouldn't we be able to see the Big Bang? If the Big Bang occurred 13.8 billion years ago, its light would just now be reaching Earth. So, do we see it? Yes, we do. We've observed the moment of the Big Bang, but its light has traveled for so long and weakened so much that it's invisible to the naked eye. We can only detect it with instruments. This is known as the Cosmic Microwave Background Radiation, CMB. The CMB was first detected in 1964. It represents the earliest snapshot of the universe, the light from the Big Bang itself. This image proves that the universe indeed began with a massive explosion. So, where was the Big Bang's explosion point? Surprisingly, it's right where Earth is.
Why?
Because the Earth is part of the universe's expansion from its core. In fact, every point in the universe is part of the explosion's origin. The universe is a peculiar phenomenon. It has no single explosion point. Every point emerged from the center. As a result, every point can be considered the explosion point. Where, then, is the edge of the universe? It's the outermost layer of the initial explosion, constantly expanding outward. Where is this outermost layer now? According to calculations, it's 46.5 billion light years away. We can't see this edge directly, but at a distance of 13.8 billion light years, it left behind a faint trace, the cosmic microwave background radiation. We've observed this background radiation, but it took 13.8 billion years to reach us. Meanwhile, the edge itself has continued expanding to 46.5 billion light years away. This expansion is faster than the speed of light, about three times faster, in fact. Does this mean 46.5 billion light years is the universe's edge? Not necessarily. Here's an analogy. When you stand on a beach and look at the horizon, it seems like the edge of the world. But when you reach the horizon, you find another horizon ahead. Similarly, no matter where you are in the universe, the edge is always 46.5 billion light years away. This makes some people wonder, could the universe be spherical like Earth? If so, would traveling far enough eventually bring you back to your starting point? Could it be that leaving Earth and flying outward endlessly would ultimately bring you back to Earth? This possibility is not out of the question. But if the universe is a sphere, it means it must have curvature, right? It would have a certain arc. So, in 2005, NASA conducted measurements to investigate this. Using the principle that the sum of the angles in a triangle is 180 degrees, they measured the universe and found that, within a range of 10 billion light years, the universe is flat. This suggests that the universe might not be a sphere, but rather an infinitely extending plane. Logically, if it's a plane and not a sphere, there should be edges. But where are these edges? That remains unknown. In theory, if you kept flying outward, you might never return to Earth because there's no curvature to guide you back. Now, let's discuss the last question. In a universe this vast, where can humanity go? With our current technology or even future advancements, how far into the universe can we actually travel? Science fiction often portrays humans hopping from one planet to another, venturing across the universe. But where can we realistically reach? The fastest speed in the universe right now is the speed of light. Even if we somehow build a spaceship that travels at the speed of light, without considering human lifespans, this spacecraft could never leave our local supercluster, specifically, the Virgo supercluster. We might be able to reach the Andromeda galaxy, since it's only 2.5 million light years away. At light speed, it would take 2.5 million years to get there. We'd likely die long before arriving, but the spacecraft could make it. Beyond that, reaching other galaxies becomes almost impossible, no matter how much time passes. The reason is that the universe is expanding at an accelerating pace. The expansion outpaces the speed of light. So instead of drawing closer to your target, you end up moving farther away. As you keep flying, you get further from Earth, and your destination drifts even farther away. This is because the space between you and everything else is stretching. Even with more advanced technology and faster spacecraft, leaving our local supercluster or even our local group of galaxies is impossible. At best, we might reach the Andromeda galaxy. But by the time we get there, Andromeda and the Milky Way will likely have merged into a single galaxy. In the end, we are confined to our galaxy. There's nowhere else to go. What about other methods? There is one potential solution. If speed has reached its limit, light speed, then we need to address the distance problem by adjusting something else. Time. As we've mentioned in previous discussions, time can stretch or contract. By manipulating time, we could theoretically make the distance seem shorter. For example, light travels 300,000 kilometers per second. But what if we stretch a single second to last 10,000 years? In that case, the distance traveled in that second would be far greater. Through time manipulation, escaping the local supercluster might be possible. The universe's accelerated expansion doesn't just trap us in our local group. It also has a chilling implication. As galaxies continue to move away, faster than the speed of light, they will eventually disappear from our view. This means the night sky will one day become completely dark. Future generations born in such a time would never see the stars. They wouldn't even know the universe is expanding because they couldn't observe galaxies moving away. They would lose access to the history of the universe. They would see nothing but blackness and might believe the universe consists only of their immediate surroundings, utterly lonely and desolate. Their understanding of the universe would rely solely on books. They would have to learn from records that there once were stars and galaxies visible in the sky. The universe's rapid expansion began around 6 billion years ago. Before that, the expansion was relatively slow. But something caused it to accelerate suddenly. Why? We still don't know. It's possible that ancient humans could see Jupiter and other celestial bodies so clearly because they lived when the universe was much smaller and objects were closer together. If so, the timeline of the universe's 13.8 billion years might not be as straightforward as we think. Time could flow differently depending on perspective. For some, 13.8 billion years might pass in just a few minutes. This could explain why ancient civilizations, like the Sumerian 6,500 years ago, seemed to have extraordinary knowledge. It's possible that back then, the universe had just been born. If that's true, even religious texts like the Bible might align with the Big Bang model. For example, the Bible and other myths describe the universe as beginning in chaos. Then a divine being appeared, creating light, darkness, and all things. This matches the Big Bang model. Initially, the universe was indeed chaotic, pitch black, even though it was incredibly hot. Why black? Because light couldn't escape. Photons were constantly colliding with electrons, scattering in every direction. Light was trapped. As the universe expanded and cooled to about 3,000 Kelvin, quarks combined into protons and neutrons, forming atomic nuclei. These nuclei captured electrons, allowing light to finally escape. At that moment, the universe lit up, a brief flash after a long period of darkness. When the Big Bang model was first proposed, it faced heavy criticism, even from Einstein. Einstein believed the universe was eternal, unchanging, and in a steady state. Ironically, it was Einstein's own equations that hinted at the Big Bang. But he resisted this idea, thinking his theory of relativity must be flawed. The Big Bang theory was officially proposed in 1946 by American physicist George Gamow. He predicted that if the universe started with a big explosion, there should be a flash of light left over from it. A few years later, scientists detected this light as cosmic microwave background radiation, persistent static noise coming from every direction in space. This confirmed the Big Bang theory. We are incredibly fortunate to live in a time when we can still observe galaxies and cosmic background radiation. In the distant future, this evidence will fade away as galaxies move out of view. It's not that intergalactic travel is impossible. Humanity is simply too late. Had we emerged 6 billion years earlier, escaping our galaxy cluster might have been feasible. If intelligent civilizations existed back then, they could have reached Earth or traveled much farther. But now, they are beyond our observable horizon, lost to us forever. The universe is a giant time machine. If advanced civilizations ever existed, they might have left traces or shadows in the stars above. We are lucky to witness the remnants of the universe's birth. Future generations will only see darkness and must rely on records to imagine a once vast cosmos filled with light. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe.